welcome to Chairside Live. I'm Megan Strong.
And I'm Will Schmidt, registered dental assistant here at Glidewell Dental.
Guess what's happening in today's show?
I can't guess.
Well, I'm going to tell you then. Okay. Mr. Jim Glidewell is taking Dr. Howard Farran, who you know from Dentaltown magazine and dentaltown.com, and he's taking him on a tour of the amazing facility where we fabricate our Bruxer Solid Zirconia line of products as well as other materials and devices.
Yeah, so we're getting a behind-the-scenes look, exclusive, at all of our in-house technology and all of our award-winning products. I say we get right to it, Megan.
Let's take a look.
Because of the way we do things here, as you can see, it's completely different than any other lab you'd ever walk into. It's all automated. It's got conveyors here that move cases.
Now, how many cases will come in on an average day?
Probably between all the buildings, 15,000 maybe.
15,000 packages a day.
Yeah, that's right.
So are you FedEx's best friend? Is that who this mostly comes to?
Spend over $1 million a week at Federal Express.
You spend $1 million a week with FedEx?
Yeah, with FedEx, yeah. Almost everything you see here is going to be our software. And that's one of the big things that's allowed us to grow. I mean, how do you control this many cases coming through a place? It looks like chaos. Completely organized. And I have very good people to do that. They don't rely on me for that.
How many employees do you have all together?
5,000. This is an Nikon scanner, and it scans that silicone impression or whatever impression we put in there. And then you would get something that looks just like this.
But is it scanning through the box?
It could. Makes no. But we don't do that. Right now we've got it sitting on a tree. So if you watch it, there's an impression sent in by a customer, and they're going to take that now and. It takes 53 seconds over here, roughly, to scan an impression. They do here right today, they're running several hundred impressions every day. So now the door just opened, we heard that. So we're going to stick two impressions in, and it's going to pull two impressions out. This here is we're standing in the back of it, maybe? Yeah. It's going to make a difference, got a front and back. Remember that big machine I showed you earlier, that $375,000 machine? This replaces that, and it's faster. This here is a computer tomography unit, big x-ray developed, and it's going to shoot through there and scan that silicone impression.
What is that?
That's a PVS scan.
Can I move it?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's an impression.
Just an impression.
So let me tell you when...
So I go directly from this to CAD to the machine. No plaster work, no pouring models, no die trimming.
Okay, so you make 90,000 crowns a month,
a week
and mm-hmm. track all your remakes.
Mm-hmm.
And what the young kids are trying to figure out when they get out of dental school is when do they need to switch from a quadrant tray to full upper and lower trays mounted on an articulator?
Yeah, just to make sure that sometimes your occlusion will give you enough to interdigitate those things so that they know where the centric is. But sometimes you're missing teeth and they're floating around. And the subconscious in a person's mind, they know where their centric is, even though they have very few teeth in their mouth. But once you take them out, you don't have a subconscious to put those two pieces together, so then you need a full arch tray.
So when can you do quadrant, when can you do full arch? What would be the...
I would do quadrant for anything. I wouldn't do a quadrant on a three-unit bridge.
So a three-unit bridge.
Yeah, I would still try to do a full mouth impression on a three-unit bridge most of the time.
Well, what if it was just two molar, the first and second molar, and there was no wisdom tooth?
Yeah, I wouldn't have a problem with that. It was on a quadrant.
You'd still do a quadrant on that?
Yeah, as long as they got the two bys and occlusion, you know.
Again, I'm trying to help, you know, knowledge has no value if we can't transfer it to the kids. She's 25. Would you... For faster, easier, higher quality, lower cost, better quality, should she start with an impression material or a scanner?
You've got to have impression material because you can't scan everything. You're going to come across cases that scanning will not work, especially if you've got a lot of tissue in there. Remember I said if you have a lot of tissue to remove, you're going to have to go in there and burn tissue, and that's not what you really want to try to do. But then silicone impression material will go in every little sulcus. You can't keep it out. Just pull it out and you got it. Yeah. So this, if you can see all the little blocks over there, they are different shades. So all those racks of zirconium.
Shades.
Those are Bruxer blocks. So then these racks will take them out, they'll pull them out, and then this little device will pick them up It'll go down through, and remember that machine that I told you about that were, it was, we're making these industrial milling machines? That's what this is. This is industrial milling machines.
Wow.
So they're very much kind of like the ones you use in your office for a chair side, but that's what this is doing. So it's going to mill those, and that robot comes through here, picks them up, and then, and this can do 2,200 units a day, this machine here. We'll do 2,200 crowns a day.
This area right here does 2,200 crowns a day.
You can do 2,200 crowns a day.
So back when you started, how many people would you have needed to do 2,200 crowns a day when you were waxing it up and casting them?
500.
500.
I would think it's about right.
So this is a 500 person lab.
Yeah.
Holy moly.
Never calls in sick.
And does it go 24 hours a day?
Yeah, you'd run this 24 hours a day. This would be lights out. You can turn it on the weekend and keep it running. Well, so what's happening here is by doing all this automation and taking, two things happen. We get a predictable product all the time. So we're getting a reproducible product. Whereas if a technician made these, he's like a Michelangelo and he wants to put a few changes onto this. Not only is a technician very expensive, but he is wanting to put his own stamp of approval on this product here. I make this blank, I make the blanks myself from powder.
And that's solid zirconium.
Solid zirconia.
Bruxer
zirconia. And then I make these pellets too here that hold it on there so that it can go in and be held by the machine when it's being milled.
And these are just for bridges?
The long ones are for bridges. The short ones are these are the short ones.
But Jim,
see how short these are?
Yeah. But I want you to answer an economic question because this argument keeps replacing itself. When the textile mills came out,
it
caused a lot of unemployment.
Yeah.
India canceled, back when I was in college, they canceled a bunch of equipment from John Deere because of unemployment. So Milton Friedman went over there and he said, what's the deal? And he says, well, I don't want to get a tractor when I have all these people that can do the job by hand. And Milton Friedman said, well, then take away their shovels and give them spoons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, something smaller, move the dirt.
So here's the deal. This increases productivity, but it replaces 500. So
automation
is that good or bad?
Displaces people. And we've become extremely automated over the past few years. And we've grown from 2,000 employees to 5,000 employees. Okay, so you repurpose your people. You have them doing jobs that are not just make work jobs. And they actually even make more money. So my
average... How come you don't go back to waxing up the crowns while they're blindfolded?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that create more jobs?
You'd create a lot of jobs if we could do that. And that's good input. We're going to use that. When the units come out, they go through a system here, and when they come out at the very end, they'll be placed in the little boxes like this here. So that's the anteriors that come out. That's what they look like in their oversized shape. Those are 21% oversized. They look kind of large to you, right? So
yeah.
That is a very large crown. But that's 21% oversized.
Bruxer.
And when it goes through the machine, this is not solid zirconia yet. This is just a porous powder. And so it has to be shrunk down 21% to be the accurate size.
So then what's different in chairside milling Bruxer to do the whole thing in an hour and 15 minutes?
Well, to mill... I can mill this crown here in 12 minutes because it's 100 megapascal. But when it's solid state zirconia, it's 1200 megapascal. So you have to use diamonds on it and you cut it slowly. And on some really small crowns, you can probably do them in 36, 38 minutes. But the bigger ones take 42 minutes. But remember that after 42 minutes, you don't do absolutely anything. You go directly into the mouth.
And you would rather do this then invest $5 in Smiles Direct Club stock?
Yeah, I don't buy stock. I don't own any stock at all, by the way. I don't own any stock.
Do you see yourself ever doing an IPO for...
No, I really don't, because then that changes. I would become obligated to the stockholders at that point, and that would restrict how I make decisions, because I would never want to risk... I'll take risk with my own money, but I don't want to take risk with their money. So this thing here, just popping boxes out like that. So the crown goes in here, an invoice goes with it, then this goes into an envelope, and it gets shipped out to a dentist with no models, and it costs us very little money to ship this because it's in an envelope now. So that's the cut down the shipping costs and all that.
And how many of these do you make a day?
Oh, we make about 1,000.
1,000?
Yeah.
And that's strictly for, that's strictly for non-model, like iTero cases coming in. So I'm 1,000 a day. These things here are what's called EDM machines, electron depth machines. They'll make super fine cuts into metal and all that. So we make parts here that you just can't make any other way. And I tell you the truth, I don't know what all these parts are, but if they want to drill a hole in something really finite, or like this kind of a milling in here, these guys will burn things in. And these two machines are called EDM machines. And they do things you can't do with a regular rotary mill.
So what are they all making here? Is this all removable?
This is removable over here, and the iTero stuff is all that in down there.
And when you say iTero, that's just iTero scans.
Yeah,
iTero scans.
I got scans.
Not clear aligners.
Right, no clear aligners. We don't make any clear aligners right at this time. Remember I said those machines that the partials really fit? Watch this laser burning here. So that's powdered metal, and it's burning on top of the old metal. It's got some parts underneath it. It's adding metal on top of it. Now the table's gonna drop 20 micron, and a blade's gonna go across it and pull powder in front of it. Okay, and then, so it'll be there in a second. And it's making,
so that's laser cutting depth into it.
Yeah, they're melting on top. There's 20 micron of metal being melted on top of that piece, okay?
And the powder is in the air?
Yeah, right. Now watch the wiper. You see the blade? Now watch it come across the top. You're looking at the top of the frames right there. Now you'll notice the frames are gonna disappear. It just put 20 micron, the table just dropped 20 micron, now the laser's on, it's gonna make another pass. So it's building up metal 20 microns at a time. If you can see these, that's what they look like when they're being built up.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that amazing?
And then what? And then what's the next step?
Well, they'll cut them off, and they look hard to get off. They're not. They clean up in a hurry and cut off all those support legs underneath it, and they're very easy. They just kind of almost peel off. But then you end up with a frame that looks just kind of like that.
Wow. And this is going to be really for a removable partial?
Yes, a removable partial, and it fits like crazy.
And what is the average cost of a removable partial these days?
I think they're $2.50, maybe $250.
$250.
Got to have the teeth on and all that. You know, they're kind of a pain to make.
Would you say this extinct the cast partial
this
framework?
Where you wax it up? Yeah,
and
exactly.
And take it off and cast it and try
it
back on.
In fact, I have this view of it. I believe that to make a frame any other way than this method is, I can't do it anymore. Ethically, I can't do it because I know I'm sending out something that's wrong. We had to look at our remakes, and we said, wait a second, a cast partial has twice as many remakes as a metal-centered partial. How could I ever send another cast partial out the door knowing that the dentist and the patient have to suffer with that? I can't do it. Well, you look at, this is the future right here. This is one of the big, big things that's changing dental technology, and it's called SLS, or Selective Laser Sintering. So that's what, and it'll make any parts. You could make copings, anything metal it could make. It really could, by the way, it could print implants. Instead of having to mill all implants, but it's fairly easy to mill implants, but you could print them. And they would grow them out, yeah. These will cut zirconia. And so that's what I make. I make these myself.
So you make your own zirconium?
Yeah, like I'll make these things for $4, or I have to pay like $14.
And who, and what is that made of? Titanium?
No, this is carbide. It's a steel.
Carbide
steel, yeah. Okay. This whole area here, this is a training center. This here is where I send people come in here to learn how to do run the software, and she's learning over there how to run, make models and all that. So this is strictly a learning center. So we do all our own training. We don't look for anybody that knows anything. We only train. If they come here with experience, we don't care. We have to unlearn them almost, you know. So that's what this is, though.
So this is when you hire someone to work in the lab, this is where they go to school.
This is where they would go to school.
You train them. And how long will they be here? How long is this?
They'll probably be in here for 6 weeks. I would think people stay in here about 6 weeks. We're designing, in a new building, we're designing a restaurant. So these are renderings of a restaurant we're building over in one of the high rises over here. And it'll be built soon. We're building that out. But we do all of our own interior design right here.
So you're building your own restaurant?
We build everything ourselves. We do it all. We do our own dry work.
But this is for employees or is this a commercial?
This is a commercial thing, but it's mainly for the one building over there where there's a lot of tenants in it.
But it's going to try to be a free, a new business?
It won't be free, but it's not a for-profit business. I don't do for-profit stuff, really. But it would be a big bonus for the people in the building who don't have a restaurant right now, and they don't have to go out somewhere at lunchtime, you know. So we try to make it convenient for them, and if they like it enough, then they'll, next time they up the rent, maybe they'll pay a little bit more on the rental, too.
So you're building out the stuff for a laboratory?
All my laboratory, everything's built right here.
And how many laboratories
Costa
do you have
around Costa Rica, 30-ish.
30 labs?
But remember, 85% of all my business is done right here in this area.
Right.
But so these are automated CNC machines too. When they cut something and you go to put it together, put the glue on it, it fits. You don't even, there's no adjusting, no tapping. You just put the glue on it and it goes. It's that amazing. And this is the wood shop. There's like 15 people work full time here doing nothing but making cabinets for the company.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Mr. Glidewell and Dr. Farran.
Yes. And if you want more from this dynamic duo, in addition to this incredible tour, you can head over to chairsidelive.com where they've got a great two-part interview with some good nuggets of information.
That's right. And then, on top of that, head over to GlidewellDental.com, click on the Education tab, and pick a nice free CE course to take.
Yes.
What do you think?
I recommend Dr. Chad Duplantis has a course right now on there, and it's entitled In-Office Milling versus Lab Fabrication, Making Case Decisions. And I think it's got some good information that you don't want to miss.
I don't want to miss it.
I don't think you should. But for today, we're all wrapped up. So on behalf of everyone here at Glidewell Dental, thank you so much for watching.
We'll meet you right back here next time.